Christ is the kingdom of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever, to the ages of ages.
Amen.
Peace to us, great the Lord.
Amen.
For peace from above and the salvation of our souls, let's pray to the Lord.
Peace
to the world, to the church, to God, and to the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
bring to the Lord the sons of God, bring to the Lord honor and glory.
Listen.
Brethren, working together with him, then we entreat you not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at the acceptable time I have listened to you and helped you on the day of salvation. Behold, now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. We put no obstacle in anyone's way so that no fault may be found in our ministry. But as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, through great endurance, in affliction, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, tumults, labors, watching, hunger, and by purity, knowledge, forbearance, kindness, and the Holy Spirit, genuine love, truth, speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We were treated as impostors, and yet are true. As unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold we live, as punished yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, and having nothing and yet possessing everything.
Peace be to you, the reader. Spirit. Christ is in our midst. It's hard to combine two great women of our church. And it's not every day that we have this problem of trying to put two feast days kind of on the same, you know, two saints. We have this problem on December 4th for sure. You know, because we have St. John the Blessed Nurse, we have St. Barbara, we have those two on that day. I'm trying to think of others. St. Artemius, the great martyr, along with St. Erasmus of the Holy God, October 20th. There's a few days where it's like you're just kind of jam-packed, you know, on these days. Of course, the Sunday after Christmas is always a big one because you're putting the prophet David the king, you're putting James the brother of the Lord. You know, all of these things kind of are kind of thrown together on the same day. And depending on the date of when these Sundays fall during after Pascha, sometimes the Sundays in May turn out to be very difficult Sundays because you have the Gospel of the day that shares its feast day also with the great saint of the church. So we find these things difficult at times, how to give face time to both saints. So without trying to do justice to both or trying to combine them together, I'll just tell you that St. Olga, for whatever reason, has always been, I'm not Russian, but I mean, from when I was young, she was always somebody that was very dear to me. And I guess it was just hearing, even though she was not the mother of Vladimir, she was the grandmother, I always found it interesting that the connection in the church between Constantine and Helen and Vladimir and Olga, and how both had offspring, albeit one generation down, that were destined, based on their tutelage, to be leaders. And you know, we call them kind of equals to the apostles with regards to Helen and Olga. But the thing that always got me about Olga is the fact that we commemorated her at St. Olga. Strange thing. Because that's not the baptismal. You know, and here we are in the church talking about all the time, you know, it's your baptismal name is how you're known by the Lord. It's what God calls you. It's your Christian name. It's the sanctified name is how you're known. And we know her baptismal name as well. Helen. And of course, she took that for an obvious reason. She took that name for an obvious reason because she found herself part of, not equal to Helen, but just part of that revival. The same thing that Helen found herself, the Blessed Helen found herself when she found the precious cross and that great joy and that great love and that great revival that was going on in the Byzantine / Roman Empire. Everything that was happening during that period of time, she found herself in the same thing in Kiev. And recognizing where she was and all of that, and knowing what that great woman of the church, Helen, did. Some historians would say even greater, much greater than her son ever was. She took that name Helen. That's her baptismal name. And yet that's not how the church remembers her. Not at all. The church remembers her as Olga. And what does that mean for us? Does it mean that we can just dispense with all the baptismal names? No, of course not. That's not what it means. What it does mean is that your identity, not just to Christ, is important, but your identity to the world is important as well. You have an identity to the world. We all do. And
Just as Christ knows you as one thing, as one person, we have to be that same person to others. We have to reflect the light of Christ. We have to shine with that identity, the identity that Christ knows us. And we know that Olga did that. We know that she wasn't a baptismal name over here, and then she was a tyrant over there. This is the knock or something that somebody might say about Helen's son, Constantine, the fact that he waited until he was much older, until he was done kind of being governed, before he was baptized, before he came to Christ, even though he had always known Christ. This is what the story is about. That he was one person in politics, and then outside of it, he was somebody else. That wasn't all. She was the same. She was consistent. And so the person that was baptized as Helen, and everyone called her Olga, he was the same person. There wasn't a difference. And many of us, when we walk into the church and we're one person, when we walk into the church and then we walk out and we're somebody else. I fall into that more times than I would like. You know, whether it's impatience, anger, whatever it is. And what saves us from that? It's somebody like St. Olga, whose identity outside the church, it didn't make a difference what you call her. It didn't make a difference what her name was. The Olga that everyone knew was the same as the Helen that Christ knew. This is why we can use those names interchangeably. The church still would never call her Helen because we didn't want to get her confused with St. Helen in May. But still, that name of Helen is still a part of her identity in Christ. And it says a lot about her. And that same kind of, tenacity and zeal for Christ is what allowed St. Euphemia to stand in the place where she stands in the church. Being a great martyr, enduring what she endured during her life. But really, the reason we celebrate her today is for standing up for truth, not while she was alive. Today we celebrate her for what she did in life. To the point where she was settling arguments, which some may say are not settled. It's the ones that walked out of the court. Another interesting point about the 450 Roman Catholics, Antioch wasn't there. They weren't. We're not representing them. Because there were problems. Antioch and Alexandria were the ones dealing with these problems with the monophysites and everything that was going on during that period of time. What do we say about this? What do we say about that? Some were going to be, it didn't make a difference what took place at the end of that council. Some people were not going to be deemed as canonical Orthodox if they maintained. And they couldn't decide it. So they wrote them up, they would score them up in a book. They score them up in a scroll. Put them in the basket of St. Euphemia and pray. Fasted and prayed for 3 days. You talk to some people after that, and they say, well, whether you believe it or not, it doesn't really make a difference. We believe in it. And then the other response that I have received is, well, that's a cheapish way of going about deciding what could be a very important theological point. But we're missing the point if we try to, reduce it down just to the fact that they couldn't decide between two arguments. It's the fact that they were close. Terminology. So close in definition. So close in all these different ways. They literally could not decide. After we were done with Arius and with his testimonies and everything that was going on, there was not something that was so close. It was very clear cut. There's this and then there's this. You if you want the truth, you follow this very clear But when you got to the fourth council, and the dealings between nature, you know, one person, two natures, right? One species, two species. Then, you know, when you get to that point, you're splitting hairs at the definitions between hypostasis and thesis. Now, we understand what those definitions are. This is what they were arguing. How to separate these things. And the ramifications of those arguments, because of how the two sides define them, different. They define them different. The ramifications of saying one nature versus two were big. And I'm not wise enough as a theologian to sit there and parse through all of them. What I do know is that if you flip-flop the definitions, you also flip-flop which one is right. And many have tried. And actually have been very close to being successful. And I'm not saying that they're right or wrong, but when you have the contemporary theologians getting together talking about the arguments with the Coptics and Armenians and all the nonsense that are out there, the non-Chalcedonian churches, it's literally terminology. The definitions are identical if you flip-flop. This is what the contemporary theologians are saying. That's how close it was then, and that's why they had to give it the same opinion. They couldn't. That's why in her prayer, she showed them the truth of what was to be the correct way of defining, the correct way of talking about, the correct way, which again would lead, because of its correctness, would lead to other things that we were able to say with regards to monothelitism. The idea that Christ has one Lord as he has two. Because we were able to say he had two natures, the way we were able to say it. We were able to say that he has two wills, but one does not conflict with the other. They were in a synergistic union. That actually, because of St. Euphemia, you're actually able to refute other heresies that came later. Heresies that the non-Chalcedonian churches, in some ways, have not even dealt with. Because, you know, they're in that fourth council. A council which I said in parentheses, Antioch did not attend in any kind of real way, because they were dealing with not just the heresies in their areas, but they were dealing with violence because of these heresies. These people were being brutal to each other. It was one of the largest councils ever attended. 630 some bishops attended this council. It's just enormous. Almost double the first ecumenical council here in the Orthodox. That's how important this council was to Council. But it also shows that you don't have to have complete attendance of all the churches to call it ecumenical or panel. And if you're going to hashtag something, hashtag the current refutes from the churches regarding the last council that we just had in Crete. God will show us in time what's going to happen. But it's in us to commemorate these saints, the saints that had big dealings with these councils. We have to do that now more than ever. Why? Because we're in a state within Orthodoxy that needs it. It needs solidarity. It needs unity. But it needs unity for the right reason. It needs unity for the right purposes. And it needs unity. That means not just on a piece of paper that can be put up there. It needs unity. But if the paper goes, the unity is that way. That's what we need. And so commemorating St. Euphemia, commemorating the fathers of these councils that are coming, we have one of the commemorations coming up next Sunday of the sake of unity, praying that everyone would fall in line, and eventually they did. The ones that left, I wish they could be. So today we commemorate two major, major saints of the church. Can you imagine where Christianity would be without Olga, the key of life? Can you imagine where we'd be as a church if we didn't get our definitions through and understand what the correctness is to say it? We'd be a different church for sure. Praise them, and we thank God for bringing them into our lives and into our consciousness. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Rise. Thank you. Of the Lord.
Thank you.
at the foe within these hills. Hear God, peace, close of the bed, with the fear of God, with faith, and with love, God, even.
Bless your heritage. Protect the whole body of your church.
mine is on St. Oliver.
Mine is on.
Oh my goodness, see, it's a word.
So I always put on the same word. Thank you.
glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and to the ages of ages. Amen. All Holy Trinity, have mercy on us. Lord, forgive our sins. Master, pardon our transgressions. Holy One, visit and heal our infirmities for your name's sake. Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, both now and ever, and to the ages of ages. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thy is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and ever, to the ages of ages.
Holy Euphemia, Christ, Holy Virgin, thou didst fill the Orthodox with gladness, and didst cover with shame all the heretics. For at the Holy Fourth Council in Chalcedon, thou didst confirm what the Fathers decreed aright. O all glorious great martyr, do thou entreat Christ, that his great mercy may be granted unto us. Giving thy mind wings with the knowledge of God, thou didst soar beyond the visible creatures, seeking the God and Creator of all things, and have found him, thou didst receive rebirth by baptism. Since thou didst enjoy the tree of life, thou remainest incorrupt for all eternity, O ever glorious Olga.
Saints, Christ, and true God, in the intercession of the spotless one, for the Lord's praise with the apostle and the Lord's.